morning and welcome to all. If you are a first-time visitor, mahalo for you coming. Yes, yes, it's always big. Thank you for coming. And if you have just a couple minutes or a couple seconds after service, we just like Aloha you, welcome you, let's get to know you and see if we can pray for you. If you are joining us on live, would you please feel free to share the link. I want to celebrate one thing that went on this past Friday. We had our men's barbecue at Pastor Tim's house, and it was so honor, not just the food, but time of fellowship. A big inspiration for me. Let me see that little big guy. You see this little big guy right there? No, not Brian. The guy next to Brian. Oh, man, just 12 years old, Brother Mitchell. He was so inspiring. Like, my man was on top of his game. But you know that it was authentic. It was real. It wasn't just because he was a Christian around other Christians that he became, you know, this holy person. But he's 12 years old. 12 years old, and he was very inspiring. And that night, I think we had probably anywhere from 16 to 18 men. So we want to mahalo Tim and his Ohana for having us. And just thank you for serving and all those who put their hands into the plow. Thank you. Next thing I want to do is just remind you that if there's any prayers that you may have or things heavy on your heart for yourself or for a family member, for a friend, please, please don't let the enemy hold you back from reaching out for prayer. I will be down here somewhere after service. Come. Come, I welcome you. And if you're a female, if you're a Wahine and you're not so comfortable with a male, that's fine. You can grab my wife. You can grab one of these ladies back here. You can grab Nikki. You can grab Tita Donna. They'll be more than willing to pray for you. Thank you for that. So I want to encourage you this morning with a scripture. So it's not just reading the scripture. So at this time, it's what we call exhortation. It's exalting God. It's giving him praise. Yeah? And honoring him through his word. So Isaiah 25:1 says, "Oh Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure." Epulikako. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for you. We are grateful that we serve not just a mighty God, not just a holy God, not just an awesome God, but the only God that is worthy of all praises. Father, we pray this morning that your mele, we pray that your word that will be preached will not fall upon deaf ears, but it will do what it was sent out to do, God. Father, we love you. Thank you for loving us first. And in your mighty name we pray. And God's Ohana said, amen. Will you please stand as we praise our Lord?
Thank you.
of every breath. Jesus, the name above every name.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Lord, we build our life upon you, the rock.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Worthy. Spirit, lead us. Lead your people.
Oh,
we just pray that you would open up our eyes, open up our ears to receive your word with meekness. Cleanse us with your blood, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen.
You may be seated.
Or anything needs finances to pay bills and move forward in the different
be read, applied, and used. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, with wisdom, life-changing, to lead us on. It's made for guidance, to teach us His ways, showing what's true, right, and worthy of praise. It's meant to be hidden deep in our hearts, daily examined as the morning starts. No greater glimpse of God do we have, a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
Good morning. Welcome to Ohana Church. My name is Tim. Thank you for joining us this morning. If you are first-time visitors, welcome. Like Kane said, you know, introduce yourself. If we don't get to you first, or we come after you. Yesterday I was at a wedding in South Point side, and then had this. I was walking up, and this guy was like, "Hey," I was like, "Oh, you look familiar." He said, "Yeah, I was at your church," and it was Stanley. So his cousin's son was getting married, and I was like, "Oh, that's right." So, you know, very important. Come introduce or meet, and that's the point of us gathering this morning, is that we would know one another. This week is week 28. I don't know if it's the same week of the year. I think it is. The way I kind of made it, but this week we are going to look at the book of 1 Samuel, and then a couple weeks from now we got the special speaker. So if you gotta miss a week, miss next week, but make sure you be here that following week. It'll be a good time. But our scripture reading this morning is 1 Samuel Chapter 1, if you are able, please stand with me as we read the Word of God together. Starting from verse 1, 1 Samuel 1, 1. Now there was a certain man of Ramathim, Sophim of the mountains of Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zoph, an Ephraimite. And he had two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other, Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. This man went up from his city yearly to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. Also, the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. And whenever the time came for Elkanah to make an offering, he would give portions to Peninnah his wife and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he would give a double portion, for he loved Hannah, although the Lord had closed her womb. And her arrival also provoked her severely to make her miserable, because the Lord had closed her womb. So it was, year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, that she provoked her. Therefore she wept and did not eat. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, "Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? Why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons?" So Hannah arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat by the doorposts of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul and prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, "O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head." And it happened that she continued praying before the Lord that Eli watched her mouth. Now Hannah spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, "How long will you be drunk? Put your wine away from you." But Hannah answered and said, "No, my lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor intoxicating drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Do not consider your maidservant a wicked woman, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief I have spoken until now." Then Eli answered and said, "Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition with you, which you have asked of him." And she said, "Let your maidservant find favor in your sight." So the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come together. I pray, Lord, that as we worshiped you, it was a worship of our heart, praising you for what you have accomplished so far in our lives. Everything that we do not deserve, you saw fit to give us, to bless us with the breath of life, eyes, ears, things that we could use to worship you. And Lord, we pray, Lord, as we meet together this morning, that as we look at your word, that you would just pour it on more and more, your goodness, your mercy, your grace, and that we would be changed. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may have a seat. So this morning we're going to look at the first four chapters of Hannah. This portion right here I'll be spending in 1 Samuel. If you want to just go there, and we'll just look at different things in 1 Samuel and then make our way. But Hannah, as we read in our scripture reading, she is one of two wives to a man named Elkanah. And Elkanah, he was a Levite. And that's important as we go down into the story. But unlike the other wife of Elkanah, Hannah was barren. She did not have children. Verse 5, we read that the Lord closed her womb. And we also read that every year, Elkanah and his wives and his children from Penina, they would travel yearly to the house of the Lord. You guys remember, I have a slide of a picture of a few weeks back. We went over the land distribution to the tribes of Israel. And at the same time, there were cities of refuge set up. And then also cities of the Levites were set up all throughout the land. So all those red dots, right? If you remember, as they traveled through the wilderness, it was one tabernacle. And the nation of Israel would be set strategically around that one tabernacle. But when they got to the promised land, the land was distributed. So what do they do with that one tabernacle? Even that gets distributed, right? The Levites. And that was the point, that the Levites had no city of their own. But they would go out and be set up shop, because the way they worshiped God and needed atonement for their sins, it wasn't smart to travel many miles and distances. So the Levites were dispersed. And so every year, Elkanah would make a trip, and the scripture tells us that he would go to Shiloh. And Shiloh was the place where there was the Levite city. The reason they would make that trip was to worship God with everything that God had blessed them with. In Deuteronomy chapter 12, we read verse 5 says, but you shall seek the place where the Lord your God chooses to put his name for his dwelling place, and there you shall go. There you shall take your burnt offerings, your sacrifices, your tithes, the heave offerings of your hand, your vowed offerings, your free will offerings, and the firstborn of your herds and flocks. Verse 7, it says, and there you shall eat before the Lord your God, and you shall rejoice in all to which you have put your hand, you and your households in which the Lord God has blessed you. So year after year, they would make their trip to Shiloh, to the house of the Lord, it tells us. And they would worship God. They would bring their whole family. They would bring the firstborn of their herds, their flocks. And importantly, they would sit down in the presence of God and eat, as far as a symbolism of thanking God that this is because of you. So year after year, they would do such a thing, to go up to that house of the Lord and worship and praise God for that. But the scripture tells us this was a very hard time for Hannah. Verse 6, in our scripture reading, it says, and her rival also provoked her severely to make her miserable because the Lord had closed her womb. Again, that trip to the house of the Lord was to give praise to God for all of his provisions and to worship God for everything God blessed them to have. But Penina, she used that to make Hannah's life miserable. Verse 7 says, it was year by year when she went up to the house of the Lord that she provoked her. Therefore, she wept and did not eat. Talking about Hannah. So here's the context we're trying to kind of grasp here is, what did Hannah have to thank God for? Nothing. I mean, there was things. But physical things she could see, who had all the children? Well, it was the other wife, right? And culturally and in the times, that was the number one expectation of the wife, to give children to her husband. But year after year, they would worship God at the house of the Lord. And in a showing, they would eat. They would eat in the presence of God as a symbolism of saying, thank you, God, for all of your provisions. It was so burdensome to Hannah that she did not even eat at that time. Verse 8, I'll just read it in Elk. Hannah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? Isn't it like men, they think we're the gift of God? Verse 9, so Hannah arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh. It says, now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat by the doorpost of the tabernacle of the Lord, and she was in bitterness of soul and prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. Hannah makes a vow. She makes a vow to God that if God opens her womb, gives her a male child, she will give that child over to full-time. shall come upon his head. We heard that a couple weeks, even last week, or a couple weeks ago, in Samson. But it was a Nazirite vow. That he would be in full service to God. That the offspring that God blesses Hannah with would be in full service to God. And as a priest in the house of the Lord. Let me just read on a little bit, verse 12. And it happened as she continued praying before the Lord that Eli washed her mouth. Now Hannah spoke in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, "How long will you be drunk? Put your wine away from you." And Hannah, she pours out her heart, and she tells Eli, "It's not the case. I am pouring my soul out to God." In verse 18 or 17, Eli answers her, "Go in peace," and gives her a blessing. "And the God of Israel grant your petition which you have asked of him." And she said, "Let your maidservant find favor in your sight." So the woman went her way and ate, and her face was no longer sad. So this was happening year after year. They would go up to the house of the Lord, Penina, where it would make Hannah's life miserable, remind her that you have no offspring. Hannah would cry. She would cry out to God. And here Eli sees her, rebukes her, thinks she's drunk. But it's totally opposite. She's broken. And Eli blesses her, says, "Let the petition you cast out to God be answered." And she was encouraged. Second group of people in these first four chapters I want to look at is Eli and his sons. That'll be in 1 Samuel 2, verse 12. To 17 and then 22 to the end of the chapter. But Eli, he was a priest at the house of the Lord in Shiloh. He was also used by God as a judge for Israel. The scriptures tell us that he had two sons who were part of the operations at the house of the Lord. They would receive and process the offerings which the people would bring to worship God. But the scripture also tells us that they were corrupt. 1 Samuel 2:12 says, "Now the sons of Eli were corrupt. They did not know the Lord. And the priest's custom with the people was that when any man offered a sacrifice, the priest's servant would come with a three-pronged flesh hook in his hand while the meat was boiling. Then he would thrust it into the pan or kettle or cauldron, or pot, and the priest would take for himself all that the flesh hook brought up. So they did in Shiloh to all the Israelites who came there. And also, before they burned the fat, the priest's servant would come and say to the man who sacrificed, 'Give meat for roasting to the priest, for he will not take boiled meat from you, but raw.' And if the man said to him, 'They should really burn the fat first, then you may take as much as your heart desires,' he would then answer him, 'No, but you must give it now. And if not, I will take it by force.' Therefore, the sin of the young men was very great before the Lord, for men abhorred the offering of the Lord." So Eli's sons, they were part of that operation of the house of the Lord when people would come and bring their offerings. But they would do what they wanted to do. They would not do it according to what their instructions were. So the meat would come and they would look at it. And provisions for the priests were in those instructions. And in the custom, they would get a three-prong fork, and they would pull, and then whatever meat came off would be their provisions, right? They were to man the temple, the house of the Lord, and that's how they would get to eat. But the two sons, they wanted the best. Even before the meat was boiled, right before the fat, and I don't know if you guys remember a few weeks back, it was kind of hard to remember, but part of those offerings was all the fat went to who? The Lord. It was to be burned up. That portion, well, that was specific in the instructions, that no one would touch of the fat. All of that would be burnt up to God. And this might be a generational thing. The older generation would say, oh, fat is yummy. Younger generation is like, oh, what is this? Cut this off of my meat. But that was the best part. And the sons, they knew that that was the best part. They would come, and the people would come with their meat, and before it's even boiled where the fat would just melt off, they would say, oh, I want that piece. But that piece, again, in the instructions, was for verse 22, continue on. It says, now Eli was very old, and he heard everything his sons did to all Israel, and how they lay with the women who assembled at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. So he said to them, why do you do such things? For I hear of your evil dealings from all the people. No, my sons, for it is not a good report that I hear. You make the Lord's people transgress. If one man sins against another, God will judge him. But if a man sins against the Lord, who will intercede for him? Nevertheless, they did not heed the voice of their father because the Lord desired to kill them. Verse 27, then a man of God came to Eli and said to him, thus says the Lord, did I not clearly reveal myself to the house of your father when they were in Egypt in Pharaoh's house? Did I not choose them out of all the tribes of Israel to be my priests, to offer up my altar, to burn incense, and to wear an ephod before me? And did I not give the house of your father all the offerings of the children of Israel made by fire? Why do you kick at my sacrifice and my offering, which I have commanded in my dwelling place, and honor your sons more than me, to make yourselves fat with the best of all the offerings of Israel, my people? Therefore, the Lord God of Israel says, I said indeed that your house and the house of your father would walk before me forever. But now the Lord says, far be it from me, for those who honor me, I will honor. And those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Behold, the days are coming that I will cut off your arm and the arm of your father's house, so that you will not be an old man in your house. And you will see an enemy in my dwelling place, despite all the good which God does for Israel. And there shall not be an old man in your house forever. So here it is told to Eli, Eli, you are doing wrong. And Eli could say, no, that's my sons, that's not me. No, it's a reflection of Eli. And what he is allowed, is allowing to happen under his command of the house of the Lord. Verse 33. And you will, says, but any of your men whom I do not cut off from my altar shall consume your eyes and grieve your heart, and all the descendants of your house shall die in the flower of their age. Now this shall be a sign to you that will come upon your two sons, on Hophni and Phinehas. In one day they shall die, both of them. Verse 35, then I will raise raise up for myself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and in my mind. I will build him a sure house, and he shall walk before my anointed forever." So God is telling Eli, you are done. I am done with your line. I am done with your household. Your two sons will die on the same day, and your hand will be cut off. And if there's any other descendants, they will not be welcomed into that position of priests. Last person we want to look at is Samuel. And Samuel, his name means heard by God. Not him, not his voice, but God heard his mother's voice, the petition to open her womb. And in 1 Samuel 2, we read that when Samuel was weaned, he was given over to Eli. Well, specifically to God, but under the care of Eli at the house of the Lord. And Samuel, he set apart to minister to God from his youth. Verse 18 of chapter 2, let me read it. "But Samuel ministered before the Lord even as a child, wearing a linen ephod. Moreover, his mother used to make him a little robe and bring it up to him year by year when she came up with her husband to offer the yearly sacrifice. And Eli would bless Elkanah and his wife and say, 'The Lord give you descendants from this woman for the loan that was given to the Lord.' They would go to their own home. And the Lord visited Hannah so that she conceived and bore three sons and two daughters. Meanwhile, the child Samuel grew before the Lord." So the age of being weaned, I think it's a similar time frame as us today, is 2 to 4 years old. So you can imagine as Hannah is saying, okay, when the child is weaned, that's when we we give him to God to serve in the house of the Lord. So anywhere from 2 to 4 years old. And Hannah, that's kind of cute, I don't know. She would sew a robe for him. Can you imagine that? Any two-year-olds? Close four-year-olds, but there. Can you imagine mothers giving away your son at that age, and is coming and visiting him yearly? Maybe she snuck out more. And well, every time you come, you would bring up a robe. Oh, how old is sister over there? She looked like 2. Wow, 2 years old. So Samuel would be dedicated and given to the service of God. And how could Samuel be a priest? Remember, it was the priests would be set apart for who? Well, what tribe was set apart to be priests? It was the Levite. Was Samuel a Levite? Yeah. His dad was a Levite. So he could be priest. Not only that, he was a prophet. In 1 Samuel 3, we see his God using Samuel as a prophet, a person who God speaks to and uses that person to communicate to the people. Let's read in verse 1 of chapter 3. It says, "Now the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no widespread revelation." What that means is God was not vocal at that time. There was no widespread revelation. There wasn't, God using many people to reveal different things to the people, it was more or less quiet from God. Verse 2, and it came to pass at the time while Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow so dim that he could not see, and before the lamp of God went out in the tabernacle of the Lord where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord called Samuel. And he answered, here I am. So he ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. And he said, Eli said, I did not call you. Lie down again. And Samuel went to go lay down. Then the Lord called yet again, Samuel. So Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. He answered, I did not call, my son. Lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. So he arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you did call me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord had called the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you must say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood and called as other times, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel answered, speak, for your servant hears. So here, God is calling out to Samuel. Samuel perceives it's Eli who's calling him. And then Eli realizes that it's God. It's God who is speaking to Samuel. Verse 11 says, then the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do something in Israel at which both ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. In that day I will perform against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knows, because his sons made themselves vile, and he did not restrain them. And therefore I have sworn to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be atoned for by sacrifice or offering forever. So Samuel lay down until morning and opened the doors of the house of the Lord. And Samuel was afraid to tell Eli the vision. Whew. Imagine, maybe, let's say he was 4 years old. Samuel gets a revelation from God saying that God is going to cut off the arm of Eli. No longer will God use Eli. Scripture tells us that Samuel was afraid to tell Eli of the vision. Verse 16, then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. He answered, here I am. And he said, what is the word that the Lord spoke to you? Please do not hide it from me. God do so to you, and more also, if you hide anything from me of all the things that he said to you. Then Samuel told him everything, and he hid nothing from him. And he said, it is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. I'm just finished reading off. So Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel had been established as a prophet of the Lord. Then the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. So God is establishing Samuel as his prophet. We won't look at it, but in 1 Samuel 7, we see that Samuel will be used by God as a judge as well. So pretty interesting. Samuel, he is given by Hannah, his mother, to God. He is a priest. He is a prophet. also becomes a judge. Then, last thing here is Ichabod. So Samuel tells Eli, okay, this is what's going to happen. Just bear with me here a few moments. Chapter 4. We see how it went down. Verses 1 says, and the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out to battle against the Philistines and encamped beside Ebenezer, and the Philistines encamped in Aphek. Then the Philistines put themselves in battle array against Israel. And when they had joined battle, Israel was defeated by the Philistines, who killed about 4,000 men of the army in the field. And when the people had come into the camp, the elders of Israel said, why has the Lord defeated us today before the Philistines? Let us bring the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord from Shiloh to us, that when it comes among us, it may save us from the hand of our enemies. So the people sent to Shiloh, that they might bring from there the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of hosts, who dwells between the cherubim. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were there with the Ark of the Covenant of God. So they lose. First round, they lose. They lose against the Philistines. About 4,000 get killed. And the leaders, or the elders of Israel, they said, let's go get the Ark of the Covenant. Like, as you remember, maybe it didn't happen yet, but the Ark of the Covenant in the battle was the presence of God. And that was an exciting thing. So the people send back, they bring it to the battlefield, the Ark of the Covenant of the battlefield. We see the two sons of Eli with the Ark of the Covenant. Verse 5 says, and when the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord came into the camp, all Israel shouted so loudly that the earth shook. Right, their confidence just boosted. Now when the Philistines heard the noise of the shout, they said, what does the sound of this great shout in the camp of the Hebrews mean? Then they understood that the Ark of the Lord had come into the camp. So the Philistines were afraid, for they said, God has come into the camp. And they said, woe to us, for such a thing has never happened before. Woe to us, who will deliver us from the hand of these mighty gods? These are the gods who struck the Egyptians with all the plagues in the wilderness. Be strong and conduct yourselves like men, you Philistines, that you do not become servants of the Hebrews. As they have been to you, conduct yourselves like men and fight. So the Philistines fought, and Israel was defeated. And every man fled to his tent. There was a great slaughter. There fell of Israel 30,000 foot soldiers. Also, the Ark of God was captured, and the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, died. Verse 12, then a man of Benjamin ran from the battle line the same day, came to Shiloh with his clothes torn and dirt on his head. Now when he came there was Eli sitting on a seat by the wayside watching, for his heart trembled for the Ark of God. And when the man came into the city and told it all the city cried out. When Eli heard the noise of the outcry, he said, what does the sound of this tumult mean? And the man came quickly and told Eli. Eli was 98 years old, and his eyes were so dim that he could not see. Then the man said to Eli, I am he who came from the battle, and I fled today from the battle line. And he said, what happened, my son? So the messenger answered and said, Israel has fled before the Philistines, and there has been a great slaughter among the people. Also, your two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are dead. And the Ark of God has been captured. Then it happened, when he made mention of the Ark of God, that Eli fell off the the seat backward by the side of the gate, and his neck was broken, and he died. For the man was old and heavy, and he had judged Israel 40 years. Let me just finish off chapter 4, verse 19. Now his daughter-in-law, Phinehas' wife, was with child due to be delivered. And when she heard the news that the ark of God was captured and that her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed herself and gave birth, for her labor pains came upon her. And about the time of her death, the woman who stood by her said to her, "Do not fear, for you have borne each son." But she did not answer, nor did she regard it. Then she named the child Ichabod, saying, "The glory has departed from Israel, because of the ark of God had been captured, and because of her father-in-law and her husband." And she said, "The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured." So the ark of God was that symbol of God's presence, and it was no longer in the hands of Israel. And God, what God said would happen, happened. Eli, his two sons, and Eli himself, they are dead. Top of that, the cherry on top, is that the presence of God, the glory of God, departs from Israel. And all she can do is, well, say it as it is. She even names her child. Not a happy, not Samuel. It's not a God hears me. It's God's judgment. And her child to her is a judgment of God, and his name is Ichabod. So here's some application we want to apply here. So we have Hannah, we have Eli and his corrupt sons, and we have Samuel. Hannah, she could not. Or did not and could not have children, and because the Lord closed her womb. And in her desperation, she pours out her soul. She makes a vow to God if God opens up her womb. And in chapter 1, verse 15, this is how Hannah responds. Right? When Eli is questioning her, he says, you know, stop being drunk. In verse 15, she says, that's not the case. But I like what she says. She says, "No, my Lord, I am a woman of sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor intoxicating drink." But she says, "But have poured out my soul before the Lord." And, you know, sometimes I think we miss this very important detail. And sometimes we come to God and we treat God as a genie in a bottle, and we ask of things from him, superficial things. Maybe a change in our current situation or status. And it's even worse in our society, as the worldview teaches us that we are entitled to what we deem as truth. And on top of that, they teach if you have a certain emotion behind this truth, then don't let anyone tell you what is truth. If you've got that emotion, then everyone else needs to get out your way. You know, and this thought process has infiltrated even the minds of Christians, that God is merely someone to empower a better you. That God is not the creator who holds our timeline in his hand. existed because God is gracious. Knowing she existed because God is merciful. Knowing she existed because God is loving. And the only one who could open up her womb was the one who authored her life. I think sometimes we miss that detail. Sometimes we mask our love for God in the things we do for him, but that's not the case. Like how it's worded. Hannah says to Eli, "But I have poured out my soul before the Lord." She emptied herself. First Samuel 1, verse 27-28 is that same mindset. Hannah says, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition, which I asked of him. Therefore I also have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he shall be lent to the Lord." After God opens up her womb, she comes back to the house of the Lord. When Samuel is weaned, and she commits Samuel to the Lord to serve his creator, she understands that God is the one who opened her womb. It is God who grants the breath of life. It is God that her son will pivot off of in his entire lifetime. You know, sometimes I hear people, Christians, and I cringe when I hear it. I hear people encourage, or Christians encouraging other Christians, says that you need to make God a priority in your life. I mean, what do you mean, Tim, you cringe when you hear that? Isn't that a good thing? This is how my mind works. See, I believe they mean well. But the finite mind will process that encouragement and produce a checklist. And I don't know if you ever made a priority checklist, but does that checklist ever get moved around to the level of priority? Does number one on your checklist ever get pushed to number two? Or maybe even number nine on the list? Started off as number one, but now it's number nine. It does. And my encouragement is this, that make God your everything. He's the actual sheet that your checklist is written on. He's the actual breath you need to write that checklist. An encouragement this morning is pour out your soul to God and have this perspective that everything in your life pivots off of the one who created you. Don't just make God a priority. Make him your everything. Second thing is we look at Eli and his corrupt sons. And Eli was responsible for checking his sons' behavior and cutting them off from the defiling God's instructions publicly and making a mockery of God's worship. Right, several weeks back, you guys remember Aaron's sons. Yeah, you guys forgot. Book of Leviticus. And his sons were Nadab and Abihu, and they brought strange fire. And what did God do to them? Consumed them right away. See, it was the same way Eli was responsible for his son's behavior. But he failed. He was to hear of that, right? And the most he did was lip service. He says, "No, that's bad, guys." But he used to take matters into his own hands same way, as fathers, we are to parent our children to the standard of God's elemental design. Or in other ways, we are designed to parent. We are designed to teach our kids. You know, my wife tells me sometimes, she says my delivery sucks sometimes when I'm teaching my kids. She doesn't use those words. Those are my words. But I know what she means, and as the father, I am responsible for the temperature in the home. As a Christian, as a fellow brother and sister in Christ, I am accountable to every brother and sister in here to live a life that is edifying to God. See, there is to be a greater mindset than just checking the box of attendance from 10 to 12 on Sunday morning and see you next week. As a fellow brother and sister in Christ, I am to both encourage and be encouraged, period. And that means sometimes, most times, this needs to be a practice of us, that we ask each other, where is the fruit? The God in me who changes me, where is the God? Same God should be in you. And we're not condemning, we're just saying, where is the fruit? Where is the victory over sin in your life? Where is the call to be salt and light? In 1 Samuel 4, Eli's daughter-in-law, she knew right off the bat. She knew right off the bat how they find themselves in this predicament. She says, the reason why the glory departed Israel, one, was because the Ark of the Covenant was gone. But whose responsibility was that? What does she say in verse 21? She goes, and she named the child Ichabod, saying, the glory has departed from Israel because of the ark of God had been captured. She doesn't stop there. She goes, and because of her father-in-law and her husband. See, far be it. And this is the encouragement here. Far be it that we leave sin unchecked in our homes. Far be it that we leave sin unchecked in the body here at Ohana. Let's stay reverent to God. And again, I use this word elemental design. You can ask me what that means. But In the elemental design of the body of Christ, we are to encourage each other. We are to be accountable to each one. We are to point to God, to all our brothers and sisters in Christ. And we are responsible if unchecked sin grows root in the body. Eli's daughter-in-law knew. Last thing here is Samuel. He ministered to the Lord in his youth. He was a priest. He was a prophet. A judge. I just want to finish off with looking at Hannah's prayer of praise in chapter 2. So this is after Hannah prays. a prayer of praise to God. And you know, after reading this, it's, you know, you, we're going to look at it, but you dig into it. You look at her response. It's quite fascinating. In verse 1, it says, chapter 2, verse 1, "My heart rejoices in the Lord." I'm using the NLT. "The Lord has made me strong. Now I have an answer for my enemies. I rejoice because you rescued me. No one is holy like the Lord. There's none, no one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Stop acting so proud and haughty. Don't speak with such arrogance, for the Lord is a God who knows what you have done. He will judge your actions. The bow of the mighty is now broken, and those who stumbled are now strong. Those who were well fed are now starving, and those who are starving are now full. The childless woman now has 7 children, and the woman with many children wastes away. The Lord gives both death and life. He brings some down to the grave, but raises others up. The Lord makes some poor and others rich. He brings some down and lifts others up. He lifts the poor from the dust and the needy from the garbage dump. He sets them among princes and places them in seats of honor. For all the earth is the Lord's, and he has set the world in order. He will protect his faithful ones, but the wicked will disappear in darkness. No one will succeed by strength alone. Those who fight against the Lord will be shattered. He thunders against them from heaven. The Lord judges throughout the earth. He gives power to his king. He increases the strength of his anointed one." That last part. He gives power to his king. Fascinating part of that is Israel doesn't want a king yet. But Hannah foresees what's going to happen. And even though Samuel was a priest, a prophet, and judge, that's pretty amazing. You can wear all those hats. But a prelude to next week, in 1 Samuel 8, that's not enough. That's not enough for the nation of Israel. Verse 6, it says, "But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, 'Give us a king to judge us.' So Samuel prayed to the Lord." Hannah already knew it was coming. This displeased Samuel. Verse 7, "And the Lord said to Samuel, 'Heed the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them.'" Our time as we live in today is the same as this time right here. Many people reject God. Many people are rejecting God. And you know, at first light, I look at this and I think, man, it's just downhill. And in God's word says, "They haven't rejected you, Samuel. They have rejected me." And ultimately, that's the biggest picture, the concern to have. But God, he turns that around. He uses that. And as we will see next week, it's exactly what the people need. Is a king. And he uses that to show them, right? Because that's what the finite will do. They will look, they will bring the standard of God down, and they will look to the left, and they will look to the right, and they're looking at the neighboring countries and say, "Oh, they have a king. They have a king." And they say, "We want a king too." Christ, to point of the King of Kings. One thing I want to say about Friday night is that was some good steak. Oh, wait, sorry. I said the inside stuff on the outside. Is that how they say it? The picture, and I like that there was this just different, what's the word I'm looking for? Just different categories. We had fathers, we had sons, we had father-in-laws, we had grandchildren, right? We had all of those just different levels happening. And we didn't just eat, we looked at scripture, and I was surprised. We talked about 45 minutes at the end, I think. But the talk was on, well, what is, you know, godly men. And everyone who was there was just, encouraging each other. It's crazy. But the idea came to me is about alignment, right? And we were talking about the standard. Is there a standard in this world? And we all agreed there is only one standard. It is the Word of God. And the question was, okay, how do we encourage that? And the idea, this illustration of alignment came to mind. You know, alignment when you your car, when it's not aligned, starts drifting. I'm not a mechanic, but I think mechanically, this is a true saying, a true thought is, if you don't fix that, not only your tires, right, get uneven wear, but maybe your ball joint, your control arm. I Googled some names before. I hope I'm telling you. No, I'm just kidding. I used to work at a gas station, but that's another story. Right? But stuff gets broken over time, gets damaged. You think about our bodies. How many of you have a chiropractor on speed dial? No? You wish you did. What happens if the back is out of alignment and you're walking all crooked? Is it just your back? No, it pulls in your hip, right? All down. And you say, oh, crazy. And then you go to a chiropractor, you get aligned, they're like, oh, champion. It's the same thing. That alignment is to happen at a constant rate. The thing we discuss is that we are responsible. We are to be the ones. And we had my friend Pastor Phil, and I think he used passion. What's the other word? Consistency. Oh, you guys are listening. Passion and consistency. And basically he was saying, don't give up. It is us. In God's elemental design, that we are to teach the next generation, to teach our families, to point to God. And somebody commented, the world doesn't even know what to point at or what to shoot at the target. I think it was Brian. We are responsible to tell the world about who God is. That alignment to the standard of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that after all the dust settles, after all the false gods, after Satan and his temptations, after all of those things settle, we have a clear picture of what is rest. It is your hand, your provision that you provide the way back to you, to be in your presence. And it's through your only begotten Son who laid his life down so that the things of this world each other's lives. In your design, it is so needed. Let us not be the ones responsible for not teaching, to not edifying, to not holding each other accountable, to have sin unchecked. Empower us to be salt and light, no matter our age. Make it clear. Connect the dots in our life and call us to be what you want us to be for your glory and your honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's respond with some praise and worship.
Where Jesus bled and died.
54 through 57. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
God. A few announcements before we close is the prayer. As Kanye said, not only today, yeah, not only today. If you guys throughout the week you need prayer, you can hit up any of us. Kanye first. No, just kidding. Any of us. If you don't have my phone number, I'll give it to you. So prayer, and then second thing is hula. Hula team practice is on Thursdays only, 3:30 here at the church, 3:30 to 4:30. So no longer Tuesday until further notice, but Thursdays only here at the church. And then the last thing, we don't have a slide for yet, but I think we got to get this out there. On August 19th, our friend, I think he spoke here before, Chris Bruno, will be having a workshop in just digging into scripture. If you want to be here, it's August 19th. It will be in the morning. I think it's a three-hour period from like 9 to 12. Lunch will be provided by the church. We'll have more information, maybe a sign-up sheet, so we can figure out how much people will attend. But he'll be digging in to the book of Ruth and just teaching how to break it down. So men and women, I believe, right? It's men and women. If you're going to learn how to dig into the scripture a little bit more, it'll be a good time. So August 19th. And that is it, I believe. Is there anything else? Well, I'll pray and then we'll be done. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Again, I pray that, Lord, your word would not fall upon deaf ears. And your word would not just last and fizzle out by the end of today, but your instruction would continue with us throughout the week. That the perspective we need to have in your design as one body, as brothers and sisters in Christ, pointing and encouraging one another towards your goodness. I pray, Lord, we would not put that on the back burner because we know Satan does not put that on the back burner. But as the scripture Brian read, victory is yours. we believe in that. Let us not let